discuss about exostosis. Exostosis are nothing but benign bony overgrowths. Right? Benign bony overgrowths. That is the most important definition. These exostosis in maxilla are divided into three types. That is based on the location they occur. Right? First one is palatal torus or torus palatinus and lateral palatal exostosis. Torus palatinus is nothing but in the midline of hard palate. And these lateral palatal exostosis are on the lateral aspect of the palatal surface in this region, in the maxilla, like that. These are the small bony prominences on the lateral aspect of the palatal side of the maxilla, alveolar process, right? Then buccal exostosis is nothing but the buccal aspect of the alveolar process, right? Mostly they will occur in this region, like this. So among this, the most important one is palatal torus, and I will discuss about that. In mandible, we have mandibular torus and buccal exostosis, same like this. Okay, so these are the classification of the exostosis. Among this, palatal torus and mandibular torus are commonly asked short answers or very short answers, right? Then we'll discuss about those things. For completely the matter and technique of removal is almost same for palatal torus and mandibular torus. First, the content list is, we have to write the definition, then incidence, etiology, characteristics, indications for removal and splint fabrication, surgical technique and complications, right? For definition, first we'll discuss about palatal torus. Palatal torus is nothing but the benign bony overgrowths which occur in or which is found along the midline of hard palate, that is along the midpalatal suture, right? You can see here, this is the midpalatal suture. So this is the midpalatal suture. So it is found along the midpalatal suture. That is the definition. Then incidence, it is almost 20 to 25%, and it is more common in female. Right? That is the incidence. And etiology. Exact etiology is not known. But some of the suggested etiological agents include as a stimulation to the function, that is functional response to mastication and superficial trauma, as a response to trauma, and developmental or hereditary. These are the some of the suggested etiological agents, but exact etiology is not known. Then characteristics, what it contains, exactly same what maxilla or mandible contains, cortical bone along with the cancellous bone, right? Same torus also includes outer cortical plate, some of cortical bone and inside cancellous bone. That's all. Size and shape varies, right? But palatal torus is most commonly nodular in shape, right? Nodular in shape, and the overlying mucosa is less vascular. Then indications for removal, these are the most important thing. Indications for removal, when it is large enough to interfere with speech and mastication, most important thing. When the torus size is large enough to interfere with speech or mastication, then the overlying mucosa is ulcerated and it is not healing. That is the second indication. And when it interferes with the denture construction, especially if the palatal torus extends to the posterior palatal seal area, that is the PPS, which is the most important landmark in obtaining retention when you are constructing complete dentures, PPS, posterior palatal seal. So when this palatal torus extends to PPS area, then you have to definitely go for removal before the denture construction. So only there are three indications for removal, right? Then splint fabrication. After the removal of the torus, to avoid the hematoma formation, we have to insert splint, right? So before surgical removal, we have to take the impression and we have to pour the cast. On the cast, we have to remove the torus. And again, we have to make a base plate on that. That will act as your splint post-operatively. Right? So that is the splint fabrication technique. Then coming to the surgical techniques. The surgical technique is same. This one. Right? First, we have to do the LA. For palatal torus removal, you have to go for bilateral greater palatine nerve blocks along with the nasopalatine nerve block, right? So that is the LA. Then incision. Incision is nothing but the, for palatal torus removal, we'll take a midline incision, right? So this is the palatal torus. First we'll take a midline incision like this, along with the anterior and posterior releasing incisions. These are the anterior releasing incision and these are the posterior releasing incision, right? Midline incision with anterior and posterior releasing incision. That's all. That is the incision. After that, what we have to do? Flap elevation. We have to completely elevate full thickness flap. That is mucoperiosteal flap. After flap elevation, you can see the torus, right? So in this diagram, you can see here, this red colored one is nothing but the flap elevated. Flap elevated on both sides, and that flap is sutured to the alveolar mucosa. Right? You can see here clearly. This is the coronal section. Right? In this case, these are the inferior nasal concha, and this is the palate, right? Horizontal plate of the palate, and this is the alveolar process, and this red colored one is nothing but the mucosa, and this blue colored one is nothing but the torus. So what I have done, we'll place an incision here and I will elevate the flap, right? In this diagram you can clearly see I have elevated the flap and I will place a suture here, right? Elevated flap is sutured to the alveolar process, right? This is the, these diagrams are two are same. After elevation of the flap, we have to remove the torus, that is bone removal in the torus region. When the torus is large enough, if the torus is pedunculated and small one, then you can directly go for bivalve osteotome use to chip off that torus removal. But when the torus is nodular and when the torus has the broad base, in that case, with the use of rotary burr, right, rotary micromotor, you have to divide this torus by making horizontal and vertical grooves in the torus like this, right? So if this is the torus, I will make horizontal grooves and vertical grooves to divide the torus into small pieces with the rotary burr. After making these horizontal and vertical grooves, we have to take the bivalve osteotome and chip off all these small pieces. This is one type of removal method. The another type is, you can use this rotary burr to clearly contour that area, completely contour that area, grind that area, right? That without using the mallet. When you are using the mallet, you have to take care not to perforate the cortical plate, right? That will result in the oronasal communication. This is the surgical technique, that is bone removal. After gross bone removal, you have to contour and smooth. Contouring and smoothening. You can contour with the chisel, or you can contour with the file, right? Bone file, or you can contour with the rotary instrument also, right? After that, you have to irrigate and remove of excess tissue. Due to the torus, the overlying mucosa is excess, right? So that excess soft tissue must be excised, right? And after excision, you have to suture. And to prevent the hematoma, the splint we have already prepared should be inserted, and that should be there for 3 to 7 days. And you can go for full mouth impressions and denture construction after 3 to 6 weeks, right? This is the flowchart for your surgical technique removal. In this diagram also, after elevation, we'll remove this blue colored torus, and after that we have to suture, and this black colored one, complete black colored one, is nothing but the splint inserted. The main purpose is to adapt the mucosa to the underlying bone, right? So that hematoma formation can be avoided. If there is hematoma formation, that area will not heal, or that area will undergo wound dehiscence. Wound dehiscence, are again, the if clot organizes, then it may result in the bone formation again, right? So that is the surgical technique. Then complications, same, hemorrhage or a hematoma and formation of the oronasal communication and wound adhesions. These are the complications. This is about palatal torus, right? Now we'll discuss about mandibular torus. Mandibular torus, definition, nothing but location, right? It occurs on the lingual aspect of the alveolar process in mandibular premolar region above the mylohyoid line. That is important, above the mylohyoid line. In premolar region, these two are most important PG bits. Mandibular premolar region, mandibular torus, most common location. Then incidence 5 to 10%. Then etiology same, right? Functional response are like a superficial trauma, developmental, everything same. Then characteristics also same. It contains cortical bone and cancellous bone also. Then indications for removal same, right? Large enough to interfere with the speech and mastication or ulcerated mucosa, everything same, right? Then splint fabrication is also same. We have to take the mandibular impression and pour the cast like. Then surgical technique is also same. LA, you can do it under local anesthesia by giving infraalveolar nerve block along with the lingual block, right? That is the LA. Then incision. Incision, if the patient is completely edentulous, then you have to take a incision in the middle of the alveolar ridge, right? Like in this case, you can see here, this is the mandibular torus, blue colored one, and this is the mandibular teeth, and this is the edentulous mandibular molar ridge. Then this is a retractor retracted in the tongue, right? So in this case, the incision could be in the edentulous, ridge region. You have to take a incision along the crest of the ridge like this, right? This is the incision in the edentulous region. When the teeth are present, you have to make the crevicular incisions, right? Like this. Crevicular incisions on the lingual aspect of the teeth. That is incision in the gingival sulcus on the lingual aspect. Generally, to expose the mandibular torus, you have to make the incision from mandibular molar to incisor ridge. After incising like this, you have to elevate, right? Next step, same. We have to elevate. Then you have to remove the bone in the torus region, right? So this blue colored one, you can see here, this red colored one is nothing but the flap elevated. And this is the region exposed. This blue colored one is nothing but mandibular torus, right? So with the chisel and mallet, or you can use the rotary burr, the same, okay? So you have to remove that bone. After removing bone, you have to contour and smoothening, then irrigate. Again, then you have to remove the excess tissue, then suture it. And after that, you have to place the splint. Everything same, right? Then complications, again, hemorrhage, hematoma. One important complication is, when you are removing the bone, if your chisel slips, it can perforate the floor of the mouth. To avoid that, you have to place a protective periosteal elevator below the torus, right? So that is the important complication when you are removing the mandibular torus. So among exostosis, palatal torus and mandibular torus are important one. Then lateral palatal torus, you can see in this diagram, right? This is the maxillary ridge, and this blue colored one are nothing but the lateral palatal torus. So again, you have to place a incision like this along the crest of the edentulous region like this, and you have to elevate, and you can use the chisel and mallet to remove, or you can use the rotary burr also, right? That is about lateral palatal exostosis. Buccal exostosis, whether it could be in the maxilla or whether it could be in the mandible, so the exostosis will be in this region on the buccal aspect of the alveolar process. So again, you have to make the incision along the crest of the alveolar ridge like this, right? And you have to elevate. You have to make an envelope flap, right? And you have to make elevate the mucoperiosteal flap, and then you have to remove. If necessary, you can take the releasing incisions also, right? This is all about the exostosis, and you have to draw these diagrams, and you have to write the flowchart also. This is all about exostosis. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.